I want you to take your Bible and turn, will you please, to 2 Kings chapter 4. I'm going to speak to you today on a prophet, a widow, and a pot of oil. 2 Kings chapter 4 is page 424 in the original Scofield Reference Bible, the King James Version. We had a few visitors to come in since we welcomed our visitors. We're glad to have all of our visitors today. Always glad to have you to visit with us here at Northside. I do have, I believe, about five Bibles left. The old original Scofield Reference Bible, the King James Version. In case you're thinking about getting one for somebody's Christmas gift, I can save you about $10, maybe more, on the Bible. I have five left. When they are gone, I won't be able to have any more this year. Now, this tape today will be tape number 309. If you'd like to have the tape with the music and the message, just write in and say, send me tape number 309, or send me the tape on the prophet, the pot of oil, and the widow. Be glad to get it in the mail to you. They're $3 each, and the gift is used to help to pray our radio expense. We have to order tape. We have mailing expense and other expense, plus our payment to the radio station each week. And we work this together in getting out the gospel. Unless God's people work with me, it would be difficult for me to try to carry on at my own expense. I couldn't do it. But I thank God for those that love the Lord, can see the real need of this ministry. Someone is telling me the other day, I met a gentleman over in Danielsville, and he was telling me about his mother, or either dad, I really forget which, but one of them, they were bedfast and dear elderly people, and he's telling me what our radio ministry meant to them in the last years of their life. Well, that's why we have the program. We want to be a blessing and help to shut-ins and people that can't get out to church as others. So you pray for me and write to me next week. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. We're already receiving some beautiful Christmas cards. We cherish them very highly. My wife takes them and decorates our living room. They're very beautiful. We cherish them very highly every year. So we appreciate the beautiful Christmas cards that you're sending to us. May God bless you. Now, if you're thinking about the Holy Land tour, we're trying to get organized, trying to find out where we stand, what we're going to be able to do pertaining to our proposed Holy Land tour for March of next year. And the next 2 weeks will tell the story. And if you're thinking about this tour, then you get in touch with me within the next 2 weeks so we know what we can do and what we cannot do in this respect. And if you'd like to have a brochure on the tour, just write in and say, Preach Edward, send me a brochure on the Holy Land tour. This tour calls for 8 days in Israel, 2 days in London, England. And it'll be in March of next year. We plan to fly the Swiss Airlines, which is the most safe airlines flying today, since Switzerland is a neutral country. And we'll know what the score is within the next 2 weeks about the tour. But if you are thinking about it, I want to send you a pastor, or maybe your pastor's wife, somebody listening today, you're not in church, maybe for some reason or another, or you want to send your pastor, your pastor's wife, or a friend or a neighbor, no greater thing than you could do for them than to send them on this tour. It'd be invaluable to their ministry. All right. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, Thy servant, my husband, is dead. Thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord, and the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondsmen. And Elisha said unto her, What shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, Thine handmaid hath not anything in the house, save a pot of oil. Then he said, Go borrow thee vessels abroad of all thine, even empty vessels, borrow not a few. And when thou art come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shall pour out unto thee all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full. So she went from him, and shut the door upon her, and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out. And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, bring me yet a vessel. And he said to her, there is not a vessel more. And the oil stayed. And she came and told the man of God, and he said, go sell the oil and pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children of the rest. That's reading from 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Now we find here God blessing a pot of oil. We find a widow woman, we find a prophet. We find that she had sons. And this miracle of the oil is a true type of the Holy Spirit and His power to meet our human needs. Now someone has thought, maybe some Bible scholars seem to think, and I think Josephus, a contemporary of Paul and Jesus, said that this man was Obadiah, this prophet that had died. We're not sure about that. But anyway, we find that he was a young prophet. And so we find that he died and left a wife and some sons. Now she was devout in the manner of her address. She spoke to Elisha in a reverent spirit. She spoke kindly of her deceased husband. Thy servant, thy husband is dead. And she was anxious about her living sons. And her motherly heart was filled with sorrow at the thought of her sons being a soul. So you can see, you find here a mother's heart. And we find, of course, that God is coming on the scene. God is doing something to help out this family. Now I want us to notice several things about this widow woman, about the prophet of God, about her sons, and about this pot of oil. There's a message here for our hearts. And we need to realize that God can help us, and God will use His Spirit of God to help us, the Holy Ghost of God. Now notice, first of all, the circumstance. Now death had robbed this woman and her two children of a father. It's always sad to see a mother that's left with children, a widow woman, to try to care for her children, and the husband gone on into eternity. It's very, very sad. Sad indeed. And so this woman here was left. She had two sons. Her husband was a young prophet. He was a young preacher. And it grieves our hearts to see mothers having to rear children when their husband is gone on to be with the Lord. Now, God tells us in His Word, never mistreat a widow woman and orphan children. God is looking down upon that situation at any time. If you take the advantage of a widow woman left behind and her children when her husband is gone, God Almighty will take care of you. God will deal with you. That's a very dangerous thing. We're warned about that. A lot of times you have businessmen today. Not all businessmen, of course, but some businessmen will take the advantage of a poor widow woman and her orphan children in a business deal, or maybe for other reasons. And God Almighty is looking straight down from heaven on a situation like that. And God will bring that person into judgment, and God will deal with that individual. I know we have a lot of children today that running around without both father or mother because of separation, because of divorce, and that's sad indeed. What touches my heart is for a man to die and leave a widow behind with little children to try to rear, take care of them. That's the case here. I was reading the other day, now you listen to this, let me have your ears. Keep your feet on the floor and look at the preacher. I was reading the other day where that 80% of all couples that live together before they get married, 80% of them end up in divorce. Couples that live together before they get married, Then go ahead and get married. 80% of them will divorce later. You're taking a real chance whenever you marry somebody you're living with when you're not married to them. Now, not all of them might end up in divorce, but 80% of them will end up in divorce. Not only that, but it's wrong and sinful and wicked to live together as a married couple when you're not married. That's sinful, that's wicked, that's ungodly, and that should not be. And then when the marriage does consummate, then you find that most of them divorce later on. Now, we find here that this woman's husband died. Now, that happens sometimes. The man died. Her husband went on and left the woman and the two little children. Now there was a cry. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophet unto Elisha said, "Thy servant, my husband, is dead." Now when Elisha come around, when he came to this woman's house, she went out and cried to the men of God. She said, "My husband is dead. Thy servant, my husband, is dead." Now, evidently, Elisha knew this man, whether it's Obadiah or not. He knew this man, and she said that he's dead. Now, hunger, separation, and sorrow were facing them. Here was a woman, had no money, her food had run out, had no means of taking care of her and her two sons, and she was in trouble. She was living in poverty. She was living in need, and God knew that. Now, God had called her husband, who was a prophet, a young prophet, home. God never makes any mistakes. It's hard sometimes to figure these things out. We may wonder why God took this young prophet. He was a good man, according to their testimony. He loved God. He's a servant of God. And yet God took him home and left his wife behind with two sons. And it's hard to understand that. But you must remember this. Had that not happened, this would never been in the Word of God. See, by that happening, this was placed in the Word of God, and it's been a help to multitudes of people since that time. And so we find here that the man is gone on, and God knew what was best for the situation, and God took care of her. And things many times will happen you can't understand. You just say, "Well, I can't see how in the world that God can be glorified in what's happening." Well, be patient. God knows what he's doing. God's on the throne. God knows all about every situation. And that's the circumstance. Second, and notice the creditors. The creditor had come to take unto him my two sons to be bondsmen. Verse 1. "And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord." Now this woman said to him, "Thy servant," the young prophet, he was a servant to Elisha, maybe one of the prophets in his school in days gone by. And she said, "Thy servant knowest that he loves the Lord. Thy servant did fear the Lord. He's a good man. And the creditors come to take unto him my two sons to be bondsmen." Now, under the Levitical law, the creditor could do that. He could take a man as a bondservant until the debt was paid. If you read Leviticus chapter 25, you'll find that's in the Word of God. If a person owed something, then couldn't pay it, then they could come and take a man's children, his son, and take him, and he could be a servant to the man he owed the debt to until a certain period of time, until it was paid. And of course, that certain period of time usually was the year of Jubilee. When the year of Jubilee came around, he'd be set free. If the debt wasn't even paid off, he'd still be a free man at the year of Jubilee, which happened every 50 years. Now, we don't know how long before Jubilee when this took place. Her sons may have only been there 5 years, maybe 10 years, less or more. But they were about to take her two precious sons away from her because the older debt they could not pay. And she's worried about this. And then the man of God comes on the scene. God comes to her rescue. I'm glad we have a God that'll come to our rescue. Now, I want to say to you today, if you're a widow woman, your husband's going on to be with the Lord, and you're left behind with debts and obligations and responsibilities and children, I want you to know this. God knows all about that. And God is watching over you. He has his eyes upon you. And if you're a born again believer, if you get on your knees and talk to your Father in heaven, God will do something about it. I believe that with all of my heart. Widows and orphans are very close and very dear to the heart of God. If you're not a born again believer, you need to get saved so you'll be in a position to tell your Father about it, and God is able to come to your rescue, and He will. You must remember that. That happened here. Now the debtors was coming to take away her two sons. We're going to take them as servants. They'll serve me for the debt they owe. We don't know what they owed the money for. It may have been for food or maybe a dwelling place or some other obligation that had to have money or some means to take care of their livelihood. But they owed the money. They owed the debt. And they couldn't pay the debt. And the debtors said, "We're coming and get your sons and let them be our servants until that debt is paid." I can imagine the grief of this young widow. There she just lost her husband, the young prophet of God. There she had no money, no food. And there she had two sons to care for. And her heart was grieved. I just surmise that she prayed day and night and said, "Oh God, I want you to help me. I don't know what to do. I don't know which way to turn, Lord. They're coming to take my sons away. I've lost my husband. And Lord, I want you to please help me." And God said the old prophet Elisha, the old bald-headed prophet, "I want you to go to this certain house, this widow's home." Notice number three, the cry. "And there cried a woman." That's in verse one. "There cried a woman." The Bible is full of stories about those who in desperation cried unto God. "There cried a woman." She was weeping, tears rolling down her cheeks. She was calling on God. When the man of God came on the scene, then she turned to him for help. And this cry, of course, was directed to Elisha, the prophet. When he came on the scene, she began to weep. And she said, "Preacher, I don't know what I'm going to do. They're coming after my sons. I've been deprived of my husband. I don't have any money. I don't have any food in my house. We don't have anything, sir. And I need help. I just can't bear the thought of giving up my two boys. Preacher, could you help me? Prophet, could you do something about it? Could you pray to God to help me? My husband was a good man. You know him. He was one of your young prophets. He was a good man, a man that lived honest before God, and a man that lived right. And could you do anything about helping us out?" Well, the old prophet of God could do something. She came to the right man. She came to the old prophet to get a hold of God and get something done. Now notice number four, the confession. "Thy handmaid hath anything in this house. Look at verse 2. "And Elijah said unto her, What shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in thy house? And she said, Thine handmaid has not anything in the house, save a little pot of oil." "I don't have a thing." "Oh, preacher, we don't have any food. We don't have anything in our house worth anything. Just got a little old pot of oil." Now, oil in those days were very valuable because they used it for anointing purposes, used it for cooking and so forth. As a symbol of the Holy Spirit, it's very expensive. It was gold almost in those days, you might say. Very valuable. She says, "I have just a little pot of oil." Now, before God can do anything for us, we must always make a frank confession of our situation or of our life or our impoverished condition. We must come clean before God. We must be honest before the Lord. We must be truthful before God if we expect God to do something for us. So this poor widow woman, she was very honest. She said, "Preacher, I don't have anything in my house but just a little old pot of oil. That's all we have left. Everything else is gone, sir. And they're coming to take my sons away. And they'll be servants. They'll be servants in the debtor's farm, in his vineyard. They're coming after them. And I would even have my sons, sir. I'm in need." And she made a confession. Now, if you expect God to come to your rescue and do something for you, you must be honest. You must bear your heart to God. You must tell the truth about the situation. Open up and say, God, you know, and lay it out before God. That's exactly what she did. And before the preacher, she told him the truth. She is honest. She wasn't hiding anything in that house. And she said, we just have a little pot of oil. That's all we have in the house. Number five, notice the command, will you please? Well, the old prophet, the preacher, commanded something. He said, go borrow the vessels. Go to your neighbor. Send your sons to the neighbor's house and get some vessels. They had certain type vessels they used to pour oil in that contained the oil. Go and get some vessels. Send your son to the neighbor's house. Get all the empty vessels you can bring back and bring them in. And she said to her sons, I want you to go to the neighbor's house and the next door and the next door and the next farm, the next vineyard. And I want you to bring some containers back, some oil vessels. The old prophet said he wanted some vessels. And he said, bring them back empty. Don't bring them back with anything in them. If your neighbor says, well, I'm going to put a little something in the container, don't accept it. I want empty vessels. Now, when you come before God to be filled with God's Spirit, which is all is a symbol of the Holy Spirit, you got to be empty. You can't be filled with yourself and all the affairs of this world and same time be filled with God's Spirit. If you're already controlled by selfishness and your own selfish needs and ideas and the things of this world that distract and lead you away from God, there's no room for the Spirit of God to take over. You've got to be empty. In order for the Spirit of God to take completely control, you've got to be empty. And verse 3 then said, he go borrow the vessels abroad of all thy neighbors. Go to all your neighbors. I don't know how many neighbors they had in that vicinity. They probably had quite a few. He said, now you go to all thy neighbors and bring vessels, even empty vessels, and don't bring just a few. Bring many of them. Empty. Bring them in. Bring them into this little house here. We're going to do business with God. God's going to do business around this house today. As she said, boys, make haste. Sons, I want you to go. Go and visit every neighbor and bring back all the containers you can bring and bring every one of them back empty. I can't emphasize too much, beloved. If you expect the oil of God's Spirit to fill you, you got to be empty. You can't be filled with the affairs of this world and be filled with the Spirit. You got to be empty. God wants you to empty up of this world, and then the oil can be placed in the vessel. Your body is a vessel of God, the temple of the Holy Ghost. And then he said, we must make ready here. He said, empty the vessels. Verse 3, make ready for God's blessings. And he says, empty up the vessels. Be sure that everything is in order. Empty them up. You cannot be filled unless you empty up of self. And he said, borrow not a few in verse 3. As our faith is, so shall it be unto us. Now, if they had come dragging back one little vessel, maybe those boys had gone out and there they obtained one vessel each, and they bring one vessel each in, that would sure have been a sign of a lack of faith. You go and bring all the vessels you can bring. As your faith is, so be it unto thee. This shows God's willing to give. God said, bring all you can bring in. The old preacher said, just gather them all in. Bring them in here. Bring as many as you can. Now, what's he telling us there? He's telling us that God is willing to pour out his blessings. God wants to bless us. He shows that God is willing, and we ourselves, the only ones that can limit the blessings of God. Now, the woman had by her choice decided to limit her of wealth through the oil. Now, this shows God is willing, but she decided just to bring a certain number of vessels. Now, that was her mistake, in a sense. I want you to see it in a sense. She may have brought in maybe all she could find. I don't know. But she brought in a limited number. And when she had a limited number brought in, she limited herself of the blessings of God and the more of the oil that could be poured in the vessel. Now, we limit ourselves. There's not a one of you sitting out there today or out in the radio listening, or what can't be used of God. Every true born again believer has a gift. You don't become behind with a gift. You have a gift. You have a gift. And you need to use that gift to the glory of God. And the more you use that gift to the glory of God, the more other talents God will give to you to use to His glory. But use the ones you have. Use your gift. Every Christian can do something for God. Or you say, preacher, you know how limited I am. God knows all about you, and you have a gift, and you can use it. Did you know there's a gift of mercies? Did you know there's a gift of helps? You know there's a gift of giving? There's a gift of being faithful in serving God. Many, many gifts. I could go on and name gift after gift after gift that you have. While Paul said to the church at Corinth, that's the most carnal crowd, most carnal church recorded in the Bible. And Paul said, you all have gifts, every one of you. And I mean, that was a carnal outfit. And Paul said, you become behind and know you. If you have them, you have the gifts. Now the matter is to use them. Use those gifts to the glory of God, and you have something you can do for God. And if you want to do something for God, you can do something for God. You without an excuse. And so he said, now bring these vessels. She limited herself in this. She only brought a certain number. Notice number six, the compensation, the condition here. Now he said to her, said, you go in verse 4 and shut the door. Go into your house and shut the door. Now, when you're doing business with God, you don't need the whole world out there gazing and looking on. You ought to go in and do business with God and shut this world out. You can't bring the world in and expect to do business with God. Shut the world out. Shut the door. Shut the unbelieving world out. For God's supernatural blessings, they have no part in it. And shut them out. Shut the world out and let God bless you. And then when you shut the world out, you shut your faith in. Shut your faith in unto God. Get your mind off the world. Become shut up to God and faith in God. And then he said, go ahead and pour out the oil, verse 5. And they started pouring out that oil. They just kept pouring out the oil. The old preacher said, give me another vessel here. And they poured out some more. Give me another vessel. And they poured out some more. And he said, give me another vessel here. And he just kept pouring it all out there, just filling all those vessels. And finally he said, give me another vessel. And they said, we don't have any more. And the oil stopped right there. All the oil stopped. If they'd had other vessels, they'd have got more oil. But because of lack of faith, they limited themselves to a certain number. But they got blessings from God. As long as you're serving God, obeying God, God will keep pouring out the oil. You know, Ruth, as she served in the field of Boaz, as long as she gleaned in the field, she received handfuls on purpose. While she was gleaning, while she was laboring, not while she's sitting in the tent, but while she's laboring in the field, she got the handfuls on purpose. And while you're serving God and yielded to God and got the world shut out and shut up to God, then God can pour the oil. And He'll keep pouring the oil. And you're the only one that can stop God from pouring oil. And then whenever he filled all the vessels, what did the preacher tell him to do? The preacher said, number one, you go sell some of this oil and pay your debt. Go use the oil to pay what you owe. Those debtors that's coming after you, carry them what you owe them. You can go pay every penny you owe. You got the oil to do so. Go and pay off your debt. That's number one. Go pay off your debt. God expects us to pay our debts. Number one, to Him. Number two, to our fellow man. God said, owe no man anything. A man won't pay his yes and honest debts, beloved, can't claim the blessings of God. Now, you got to pay your just and honest debts to God and to the fellow man in order to have God's best and God's blessings. And He said, go pay your debts. All through this Bible, God said, go pay your debt. Many years ago, before God saved me, I lived in the city of Greenville, South Carolina. We could take about $4, go buy a week's supply of groceries. And so I would buy them 1 week and go pay them the next week and buy about $4 more worth, go pay that next week. Always stayed a week behind. So I decided I'd go on cash basis, and so I failed to pay the grossman. I took the $4, went to another grocery store. That's a dirty thing to do. Man had been accommodating me and letting me have groceries on the credit, and I went somewhere else, you know, just like a lot of people go in debt to other stores and places and dodge a man they're in debt to go somewhere else to do business. That's a crooked way to do a thing. And so when God saved me, I hurried down this grocery store and paid the man the $4 and apologized. You know what he said? He said, I wish some more of them fellas up there would get saved because I need my bills paid. That's what he said to me. They expect saved people to pay their debts. And so a saved person should pay his just and honest debt. So I paid that debt. And it was taken care of. When God saved me, I took care of that immediately. They paid their debt. And then he said, go and live on the rest of verse 7. Go live thou and thy children the rest. So they paid the debts off, had enough oil left to live on. Isn't that something? That shows you the blessings of God. Then notice the conclusion. Notice the cry of the need here, the source of power and the provision. Supernatural always satisfies the needs. The sons were saved from bondage only by the gift of God. These boys were headed for bondage. They were headed to be slaves. And only by the gift of God were they spared. You were headed for hell and deserved to go to hell. And only by the gift of God you have been spared. You have a debt to pay in hell because you broke the law of God. Only by the gift of God have you been spared. By God's grace, you've been saved by his grace. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Now the sons were saved from bondage only by the gift of God. The oil that saved them from debt and slavery sustained them day by day. That same oil that saved them from slavery and took care of their debt sustained them day by day. The same grace of God that will save you will take care of your need day by day. Now when the Israelites killed the lamb, put the blood on the doorpost that saved them from dying that night, they feasted on the lamb they carried in the building. The same grace of God that saves you now will keep you day by day and take care of your need. And so you must remember that. God's grace is sufficient for all needs. Do you know him today? Do you have oil in your lamp, children? Do you? Do you have oil in your lamps? If you don't have, you need to get some oil. Because time is drawing now when you're going to need the oil, need the light, so to speak. Are you saved? Oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And the moment that you're saved, God puts the oil in you. And he lives in you. And he that liveth in you is greater than he that's in the world. And he that saves you by his gift and marvelous grace can keep you day after day, day after day, and supply your needs time again and time again. And do it through his marvelous gift and by his marvelous grace. So if you don't know him today, now's the time to get saved. If you're backslidden on God, now's the time to come back to God. If you want to join this church, we receive members, then you can come and we'll talk about that. If you know the need, you need to come forward and we give the invitation on you ought to respond and come forward today. Let's stand to our feet. You've listened well. Father, I do pray in Jesus' name that you'll use the message not only to the dear people here in this auditorium, but out in the vast radio listening audience as well. God, may thy name be honored, and may Jesus be glorified, and always say adieu. Have your way in this invitation, dear Father. Thank you for the precious oil of thy Spirit. Thank you for the precious gift of God. In Christ's name, amen. Debbie's going to play for us. Listen to me. If you're in this building unsaved, if you're here and you're broken fellowship with God, if you're here and you want to unite with Northside Baptist Church, if it's any other reason you want to come forward on while she plays, come down here and let us help you, will you? Walk right down here. We'll help you. We We want to help you. Would you come while we wait?